not be your last time. Come back and visit us. There's so much going on here. On behalf of our board of directors, can I board raise your hands? An amazing group of volunteers. I love you all. You work so hard for this community. This facility that we're in is a little over 26,000 square feet, built in 1974. It is the shining example of how government and neighbors coming together can build something for the greater good. I have the mic, so I'm going to give you a couple PSAs. Just a couple things going on in our great community. Greater Syracuse Hope, Healing, Opportunity, Prosperity, and Empowerment, Anti-Poverty Coalition. We're not a program, we're not an initiative, we are a movement. Get involved. Southwest Community Center Campus Tour, April 29th to 30th. We're looking for people to sponsor our young people to go see campuses at Morgan State, Johns Hopkins, Townsend University, the Inner Harbor of Baltimore, and the Black Wax Museum. Sponsor some children and let them see what their potential is. I am glad, I am proud of Black History Tribute to AIDS Awareness, Advocacy, and Activism right here next Friday from 3 to 5. Come on down and see what we're doing. Syracuse and the Syracuse City School District invite you to donate cases of bottled water. You can drop them off here, you can drop them off at any school district, school, city hall, and People's AME Zion Church. Let's show Quint what Syracuse can do. And you just heard in the news on Tuesday the release of the consensus option report. Be heard, get involved. Be a part of the consensus discussion. Thank you all for coming to the Southwest Community Center.
The invocation presented this evening by Reverend Regina Richon, pastor of Fox Memorial Christian Methodist Gospel Church.
I invite you to pray with me. Would you bow your heads? Dear wise and loving Father, first of all, we stop to say thank you. We thank you on behalf of this beloved community. We're gathered here because of your abundant blessings and because of life itself, we say thank you. For the measure of health, we lift up your name and we thank you for the ability to be used in your work. We thank you for these who have come from the east, the west, the north, and the south. We thank you. We thank you, God, for those who even blessed us and welcomed us to this wonderful facility. In the scriptures, you say that we ought to obey the governing authorities since you have established those who have authority over us to promote peace and order and justice. So we speak peace now. We speak order now. And God, we call for justice, not only in our community, but in this world. We lift up our mayor to you now. We lift up all of our elected officials and those who you have brought together even on this evening. We ask God that you would give us concerning ears, but we also ask that you would give us critical ears, because we are indeed living in critical times. Oh God, we are burdened by poverty and we're burdened by senseless violence. And Lord, there's so many other concerns that are placed in our hearts. And so now, God, as our mayor would take the podium and utilize this microphone, we would that you would give her power and that you would give her the authority to share with us in the direction that we should go. And in the meantime, oh God, give us fellowship and give us the ability to use that critical ear to ask the difficult questions so that our beloved community might experience the greater good. And it is in your name that we pray, and let every heart say amen.
Please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance. Delivered tonight by participants from the Southwest Community Center Pride Program.
Thank you. my 2016 State of the City address. My thanks to Pastor Regina Reese Young for that beautiful invocation, and of course to our new Third District Counselor Sue Boyle for her wonderful words as well. I want to thank the children of the Southwest Community Center Pride Program for leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance. They projected so well and were so strong that I was able to hear it through double doors. So well done, well done. I want to, of course, acknowledge the members of the Common Council. In addition to Councilor Boyle, we have Council President Van Robinson, Majority Leader Steve Thompson, President Pro Tem Helen Hudson, Councilors Joe Nicoletti, Gene Kessner, Joe Carney, Chad Ryan, Khalid Bey, and Nader Maroon, all over here. Auditor Marty Masterpole for joining us tonight, and welcome our city court judges in attendance this evening. We appreciate you being here. Welcome to School Superintendent Sharon Contreras and to the Commissioners of Education. Thank you for coming. And I also want to acknowledge the representatives of our statewide and federal elected officials, as well as our state delegation, Senators John DeFrancisco and Dave Valesky, Assemblyman Bill Bangarelli, Al Sturpey, and of course our newest Assembly member, former Common Counselor Pam Hunter. County Executive Joni Mahoney and members of the County Legislature, as well as her staff, are in attendance, and I want to thank you for being here. Point of privilege and thank the wonderful and strong voice of Sharon Owens and her entire team here at the City of Chicago. Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for hosting us here this evening. Since becoming the CEO of the Syracuse Model Neighborhood Facility after she left City Hall, Sharon Owens and her team have taken on the challenge of rebranding the Southwest Community Center as Ground Zero for services, not only to the South Side, but to all city residents. Managed by a fiscally sound organization with a skilled staff and dedicated community partners, Southwest has never shied away from rolling up its sleeves, standing at the forefront to embrace community challenges and to create an environment of hope. Here in the center, you hear the laughter of children and conversational chatter during dinner time, line dancing, which I have done once, maybe I'll do it again. Line dancing here in grooves, played promoting exercise and healthy living. The sounds of giving, whether it be food, turkey, clothing, toy giveaway, or kind words. Intense community conversations to address our challenges and promote our strengths. We are extremely proud of the many services provided by the center, including its after-school programs, emergency case management to seniors and families, reproductive health services to women, men, and teens, and its Cues Cares Gun and Gang Violence Initiative that combines the resources of multiple numbers of programs designated to address these issues in our city. This is a very small snapshot of the great work done here at the Southwest Community Center, but it gives us insight into the true meaning of public service, people committing themselves to the service of others, working to provide people with the help they need, working to lift up those who have stumbled, helping children learn, helping adults find work, diffusing violence, and creating pathways to opportunity. Generating hope. This is no easy task, and the dedicated people that make sure that the doors of this center open each and every day, and the eager people who come through them all know this. These are tumultuous and challenging times, and this past year saw Syracuse as the focus of several academic studies and socioeconomic highlights, highlighting the growing rate of extreme poverty and the racial and ethnic lines upon which the scourge of poverty is felt. Syracuse is the 23rd poorest city in the United States, and 43% of our school-aged children live below the poverty line. 65% of African Americans and 62% of Hispanic Americans live in areas of extreme poverty. It has been sobering to absorb all the statistics that have come to light in 2015. But the truth is, these numbers are confirmation of what most of us have known all of our lives. Our community's economic and social struggles are nothing new, and were a part of why many of us chose to engage in public life in the first place. Still, how is it that we are seeing inspiring new projects take place in our city? Projects many of us thought would never be achieved, and yet we see such struggle. Our community is full of stark and haunting contrast. And how do we balance our excitement and our optimism with the honest and responsible acknowledgement of such troubling realities? These are feelings by which I'm sure we are all constantly torn. But we are certainly not the first to ask these questions and feel this tension. Almost 53 years ago, a man sitting in a jail cell described his frustration in seeing the vast majority of their 20 million black brothers and sisters smothering in an airtight cage of poverty in the midst of an affluent society. In his letter from a Birmingham jail, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. remarked on the interrelatedness of all communities and our inescapable network of mutuality. As Dr. King, so many years ago, saw two Americas separated by race and class, he also understood very deeply the indivisible nature of our national fate. Our fundamental national successes and failures inevitably will be shared. And the same is true for here in Syracuse. Tonight, I want to amplify our shared successes as a city, but also directly acknowledge the gravity of our city's poverty and discuss the steps we are taking and must take to address it. There is no better place to begin these steps than in our schools. A sound public education is the most sensible economic development investment we can make as a community. And it is the most powerful tool for providing children life choices and economic opportunities. We all know that the last year has been a difficult one for our schools. Implementation of Common Core, teacher evaluations, and a new code of conduct in combination with our perennial challenges of underfunding have created a perfect storm. Nevertheless, the families and teachers of our district have remained focused on progress, not excuses. We continue to see positive trends in our graduation rates. The Syracuse City School District's overall four-year June graduation rate of 55% is the highest it's been since the 2008 graduating class. And the five-year rate has gone from 54 to 60%. Four out of the five high schools are showing improvement, and the Institute of Technology at Syracuse Central led the way with a June graduation rate of 79%. And an August graduation rate of 81%. Dropout rate in our schools continues to decrease, falling from 26 to 16% in 2015. And while these numbers do not satisfy us, they are objective signs of progress. And the increases we are seeing in graduation rates means more young people with the opportunity to go on to college with the support of Say Yes to Education. And as we continue our support to Say Yes and our commitment to the Say Yes to Education Endowment Fund, we must maintain our focus on creating meaningful career pathways for all students. There are now 21 career and technical education offerings across the five high schools, including automotive technology, computer forensics, culinary arts, and the health professions. And through the Syracuse PTech program, students at ITC can take part in a 5 or 6 year program that combines high school, college, and career training. And at the end of this program, they can earn an electrical engineering technology associate's degree or a mechanical technology associate's degree through Onondaga Community College. School choice options are also increasing with the opening of the Syracuse Latin School. Delaware Primary, a dual language program, and the Public Service Leadership Academy at Fowler. And in the fall, we will open the district's first Montessori school at Lemoyne Elementary, added to the portfolios of school choices. We are also proud of the work done on the Joint Schools Construction Board. As Phase 1 closes and Phase 2 ramps up, we should mark the importance of our efforts to involve minorities and women in the project workforce. In Phase 1, we set a goal of 9% minority-owned business participation and 6% women-owned business participation. We not only met but exceeded those goals, reaching 11.9% minority-owned business participation and 7.6% women-owned business participation. That's nearly 20% in total for the project. The inclusive success of the Joint Schools Reconstruction Program and the many initiatives underway to improve our schools are a testament to the commitment we are making to our children and our community. And I want to acknowledge the efforts of Superintendent Sharon Contreras, the Board of Education, the Joint Schools Construction Board, the school district staff, and most particularly the teachers and families of our district for your faith, passion, and dedication. Thank you. The efforts of the Joint Schools Construction Board remind us of the importance of leading by example. Investment of public dollars should support economic empowerment for those who do the work of public service. And that's why this past fall, I raised the minimum wage for city workers to $15 an hour. People working full-time, endeavoring to improve our community, should not have to live in poverty. And I want to thank the council for their support of this measure and extend my gratitude to all city employees for their hard work and passionate service. Thank you. On the far end of the poverty scale are those without the stability that comes from employment and social connection. The issue of homelessness is also front and center nationally, as it should be. In the post-recession economy, many households who might never have imagined needing a food pantry or basic shelter are now reaching out for this sort of help. Fortunately, as you heard Councilor Boyle say, this is a community that is home to a dedicated network of homeless service providers and agencies that address the emergency housing needs of its residents. This network has shown an amazing ability to adapt to a new paradigm in dealing with the new faces of homelessness, namely the increased number of women and children. And not only are these families removed from the general, more chronic homeless population, but are immediately also assigned a professional caseworker support to rapidly rehouse them in permanent housing. This housing first model has been extremely successful here in Syracuse. And in the past 2 years, the number of occupied shelter beds in this community has dropped from roughly 600 a night to 380 in the first week of January this year, when our winter really set in. And as Councilor Boyle said, Syracuse has also been a national leader in addressing veteran homelessness. Being the largest city in proximity to Fort Drum, and during a time when our nation's troops are returning home from two foreign wars, the issue of veterans' homelessness looms large for this community. But through the efforts of the Housing and Homeless Coalition, headed by Melissa Marone, our community has reached what has been referred to as functional zero in veterans' homelessness. Does that mean there will be no more homeless veterans in this community? No. What it does mean is that if you are a veteran and you find yourself in need of shelter, a network is in place to ensure you will be in permanent housing within a minimum of 45 days and not be forced to dwell in homeless shelters in perpetuity. We are proud to have attained the status bestowed by HUD and to be acknowledged just last week by First Lady Michelle Obama. I want to thank the Housing and Homeless Coalition, the Veterans Administration, ClearPath, John and Lee Ann Tomino, and all of our partners for their hard work and allowing us to reach this achievement. Thank you. Syracuse also continues to be acknowledged as a leader when it comes to housing and community development. The establishment of the Greater Syracuse Land Bank is likely the most significant manifestation of our innovative approach to tackling vacant and blighted housing that drags down the values and pride of our neighborhoods. Approaching its fifth year of existence, it is now just achieving the scale necessary to move the needle on our vacant housing inventory. To date, the Land Bank has acquired over 900 properties, with 600 more anticipated in the next 2 years. They have been successful in selling 250 properties, leveraging $8.2 million in private investment, and creating local jobs that turn money back into the local economy. Those 250 sales have also returned nearly $10 million in assessed value to taxable status, and are generating approximately $400,000 in local property taxes annually. I want to thank Land Bank Executive Director Caitlin Wright and the Land Bank board members, particularly Dwight Hicks, who has just completed his time on the board after 3.5 years. Thank you, Dwight. We need this sort of community-wide approach to improve the conditions in which our citizens live. The Green and Healthy Homes Initiative is finally underway here in Syracuse. GHHI was charged in 2008 by the Council on Foundations and the White House Office of Recovery to lead national efforts and integrate lead hazard control, healthy homes, and weatherization and energy efficiency work. Locally, the Central New York Community Foundation has acted as a facilitator, bringing together peace, home headquarters, public health and social service agencies, and the city and county lead offices to create a streamlined process for connecting citizens with services that support well-being at home. This consortium recently applied for and received $1 million from the Office of Attorney General Eric Schneiderman, and a full-time outcome coordinator has been hired to start streamlining each agency's application, and the program is expected to begin accepting first customers this spring. And I want to thank all of the partners for their outstanding work on this initiative. I hear frequently from constituents the desire, not just for quality housing, but affordable housing. And I hear this concern all over the city, including downtown. And one project I am proud to discuss tonight is the one set to begin in Clinton Plaza Tower on South Clinton Street. This 305-unit affordable high-rise at the foot of Armory Square hasn't seen significant investment since it was built 45 years ago. And in fact, 60 units have been completely offline for over 10 years due to their deteriorating condition. Recently expiring affordability covenants on the property meant that the tenants there, mostly on fixed incomes and many with disabilities, faced the prospect of the building becoming market rate, possibly forcing them to leave their homes. I'm pleased to say that today, the City of Syracuse closed on financing that will help leverage almost $40 million in improvements to this building while still guaranteeing the affordability of the units. The exterior renovations will better tie this building into Armory Square and other downtown assets. But more importantly, this investment will provide much needed upgrades while guaranteeing the affordability of these apartments. The city has committed $675,000 in home funding to this project, and I want to thank the Department of Neighborhood and Business Development Commissioner Paul Driscoll and his entire team for making this possible. By developments like these, there's been much discussion in the recent months about economic development and the role of local governments in our community. We all know that economic development and growth is crucial to improved economic opportunity, job and wealth creation, and healthier public budgets. I believe that this growth must be shared and must translate to direct community benefits that create a rising tide that lifts all boats. We also know that we have entered a new era in local government, and the work of providing public services effectively, efficiently, and equitably requires new thinking and new approaches. Both the troubling turn of events associated with the Inner Harbor Project and the work of the Consensus Commission on Local Government highlight the difficult questions that surround these fundamental issues. How should a struggling community foster robust economic growth without allowing developers to take advantage of us? How do the most disadvantaged of us maintain a seat at the table when decisions are made about our collective economic future? How do we thoughtfully adapt our local government structures in ways that improve efficiency and service delivery, but also promise equitable representation across our entire community? We ask these questions at a time of tremendous economic activity in our city. $1.2 billion in the last 6 years, to be exact. But that economic success leaves out too many of our people. The $71 million renovation of the Hotel Syracuse is in full swing. And we have seen the opening of new businesses like Lee's and Steigerwald's, Wolf's Beer Garden, The Evergreen, Brillbeck's, and Modern Mall, to name a few. We completed the first Syracuse Main Street projects right here on South Ave and on Grand Boulevard on the north side. And in fact, with support from city agencies and other community partners, we will be looking forward to the development of a new Price Right grocery store just down the street at the corner of South Ave and Bellevue. This store will make this neighborhood more walkable and will help support the nutritional needs of a community that has lived in a food desert for far too long. The truth is, our progress is reaching new heights and new developments continue across all of our city neighborhoods. But while we foster a more active environment for investment, we must also hold developers more accountable to ensure consistency, transparency, and that all of our residents directly benefit from the lucrative tax breaks, not just the lucky few. Our future is bright with new opportunity. Earlier this week, the Consensus Commission released its draft recommendations of improving and modernizing local government. And I want to encourage all members of our community to take the time to review the report. Educate yourselves about the issues and the details of these recommendations, and avail yourselves of the opportunity to participate in the public meetings that have been scheduled, some right here at Southwest. This is an opportunity to state your priorities in public policy and our local governments that can help us take a long-term, systemic approach to address poverty, improve equity and representation, and promote economic growth and economic opportunity for all. This process needs diverse voices to be effective, and the details matter. I look forward to the community dialogue in the coming weeks, and I want to thank the members of the Commission for their hard work. Growth and empowerment, we must also be mindful of the foundation which this growth is predicated. And that's right, I'm once again about to talk about infrastructure. I've been beating this drum about the condition of our water, sewer, and road infrastructure for several years, and for those of you who hear me frequently speak, I regret to inform you I keep doing so. But now, my drum beat, and this drum beat, is one that is growing across our state and across our country. Not 2 weeks ago, in the city of Troy, New York, a century-old 33-inch water pipe broke, causing a state of emergency and the loss of more than 10 million gallons of water. It took nearly 5 days to repair the pipe, during which time residents and business owners were advised to limit their water use and boil their drinking water. And of course, there is the tragedy unfolding in Flint, Michigan. Our situation here in Syracuse is very different from Flint. We are fortunate to have one of the cleanest, most reliable water sources in the country. But events in Flint remind us that all levels of government have a responsibility to provide the infrastructure that supports the basic essentials of life in a community. and a sacred charge to keep the public's trust and perform the difficult and quiet work of protecting people. I often speak about our aging water pipes and roads and sewer lines here in Syracuse. And this time last year, I announced that Syracuse was one of only 14 cities selected to participate in the Bloomberg Philanthropies Innovation Teams program, which aims to enhance the capacity of city halls to solve intractable urban problems and improve the lives of citizens. We in city government believe substantive innovation is the key to our future success. And the team's first area of focus is infrastructure. And since May, the I-team has been working alongside the Departments of Public Works, Water, Engineering, and others to develop strategies that will improve the city's infrastructure in ways that meet our challenges and budgetary constraints. The team uses a data-driven innovation delivery approach, and its research on infrastructure over these past few months has been extensive. The I-team has met with city workers at every level, with representatives of other agencies and governments and utilities, hosted sessions to elicit input from city residents, and visited other cities to learn about the best practices in infrastructure management. They have studied the latest technologies, and their work culminates in specific initiatives that will create the biggest impact for our city. The proposed solutions don't require billions of dollars in investment. They can be implemented right now with creative thinking, smart new techniques, and hard work, something we specialize in the city of Syracuse. Within the next few months, city departments will be putting together the necessary elbow grease to implement these new infrastructure solutions. This new infrastructure improvement portfolio focuses on three main interconnected concepts. First, we will use data and technology to identify and inform our infrastructure management. Second, we will better coordinate infrastructure repair and replacement in our city's right of way. And third, we will improve our customer service. First up is data and technology. It would cost the city more than $700 million to replace our entire water system. And given this daunting price tag, we have focused on finding low-cost solutions that prolong the lifespan of our water system and that help us intervene before small problems exacerbate into emergency situations. New technologies on the market make it possible to identify leaks in our system before they become debilitating water main breaks pictured in the news. This summer, we will pilot sensor technology in our downtown area, where our water main breaks are the most prevalent and disruptive. You can see one of the sensors over there on display. This technology measures sound frequencies within water pipes to detect leaks, and then feeds this information into a web-based system that analyzes the information to identify problem locations. By detecting leaks before they become breaks, the city will spend less in material and labors. And an added bonus is that we can schedule leak repairs, which will be less disruptive to businesses and residents. This represents a fundamental shift in an almost entirely reactive approach to a more proactive management standard. These sensors represent a bold new approach to managing our water infrastructure. This is new for us. It's not new for us, though, to challenge the status quo and embrace new ways of doing business, even when it pushes us out of our comfort zones. We believe this is just the sort of smart approach that has the potential to revolutionize the way we manage our water system. Another low-cost approach to maintaining our water system includes better valve maintenance. Flow through water mains is controlled by thousands of valves located throughout the city, most of which are old and in disrepair. And just like your body, water valves need regular exercise to work properly, and broken valves need to be fixed or replaced. When a water main break occurs, valves shut down so the flow of water, and our crews can then dig up the main and fix it. But when the closest valve to the water main break isn't functioning, or when it's so brittle it breaks and our crews attempt to close it, workers have to move farther away from the break. And they have to find valves that work. Shutting off valves farther upstream means a larger number and a greater number of people losing water service. Regularly exercising, testing, and fixing and replacing the more than 10,000 water valves in our system will reduce the number of people affected by water main breaks. Using a special device called a Wox machine, we will be able to more effectively maintain our water valves. This machine automatically opens and closes water main valves and tracks important information about valve condition. It uses sensors to monitor valve rotation and then exercises them without breaking them. The water department will monitor our valves from spring until winter, testing 25 to 35% of the water valves each year. Exercising the valves will keep them functioning and inform our valve replacement strategy. We will also begin using sensors to inform our street repair. And this spring, we will pilot a new technology called Street Quality Identification Device, or SQUID for short. SQUID is a sensor and imaging system that is attached to a car and driven around the city. SQUID collects data on the bumpiness and roughness of a road and takes pictures of potholes and cracks. The data is collected by the device and is mapped and then used to objectively rate and rank the quality of our streets. We have been manually rating road conditions for 3 decades, and this device will help confirm and increase our knowledge about our streets. This chart shows the relative number of roads that are rated good, fair, and poor, and their change over time. As years have gone by, we have fewer roads in good condition, shown in green, and more roads in poor condition, shown in red. This type of analysis will allow us to prioritize street repair and identify appropriate interventions based on road condition. We want to use SQUID to help us identify opportunities to perform low-cost street repairs before they degrade to the point of needing more costly reconstruction, and to help us fill potholes and cracks as soon as possible after they appear. Speaking of which, in order to extend the lifespan of our streets, we will improve the way we fill potholes. Beginning immediately, when our crews are not busy with snow removal, we will designate DPW street repair crews to utilize 2 Durapatch trucks. These trucks, which the city already owns, fill potholes faster and more effectively than the traditional hot and cold patch methods. This means roads will last longer and commutes will get smoother. In addition, we will implement a new maintenance procedure called crack sealing, in which we will find and seal cracks on a road to prevent water and salt from reaching the road base, which creates potholes and leads to more rapid road deterioration. Both of these methods of repair will be part of a road infrastructure management plan in which we will use data and analysis to select the most appropriate interventions to extend the life of more than 400 miles of city streets. These new approaches to street repair will replace some of the more traditional road work that you encounter during a typical Syracuse construction season. Historically, the majority of our street budget has gone towards major reconstruction, where asphalt is taken off and then repaved on the street. This method of milling and paving creates a new road, but is very expensive, limiting the number of roads that can be reconstructed each year. Instead of the traditional mill and pave approach, we will implement a new type of top coat resurfacing called micropaving. That will allow us to intervene sooner so that we can keep our roads rated in good condition longer. This type of resurfacing is 1/10 the cost of our current mill and pave method and will enable us to improve more of our streets each year. By implementing preventive maintenance like crack sealing, pothole filling, and micropaving, the city could save as much as $30 million over the next 5 years. I'm making you all care about infrastructure, whether you want to or not. All of this work will be tied to a mapping system so we can use geospatial analysis to help us identify clusters of infrastructure problems within the city. This will allow us to make better decisions about how and where to focus our infrastructure improvements and to better plan for future construction. The second component of our infrastructure improvement portfolio entails more deliberate coordination and planning of our right-of-way construction projects among city departments, private utilities, and developers. By projecting out and mapping construction projects years into the future, we will be able to more easily identify construction conflicts and opportunities. While emergency road cuts are inevitable, this approach will significantly minimize the reopening of a road for planned construction projects after it has been paved. This dig-together strategy will also allow the city to stretch its dollar by addressing all of our underground infrastructure maintenance needs while the road is open. These actions will reduce the number of times we open a road and save us money so we can undertake more projects. We will make sure that all parties follow enhanced guidelines and rules during the actual construction project to ensure that our roads are repaired with integrity. With more stringent road reconstruction guidelines, we will greatly reduce unsatisfactory road patches that further degrade the quality of our roads. Finally, we want to make it easier for citizens to tell us when they experience or witness infrastructure problems. As many of you know, CityLine is the system that Syracuse residents use to submit a variety of service requests to the city by phone or online. Using CityLine informs us about where you need our help, and the utilization of the online version system has increased in recent years. But we have also heard that it could be more user-friendly. So you can still reach CityLine by calling 448-CITY, but starting today, you can also submit service requests using our improved, easy-to-use webpage, cityline.syrgov.net. This webpage allows you to submit service requests for things like sewer backups, trash removal, pothole filling, and then track the status of your service request 24 hours a day online or by the phone during business hours. Over the next few months, we will roll out even more improvements to our customer service system with the goal of providing more convenient ways for you to report problems so we can respond quickly. And in addition to improving service request experience, we also are improving the ways we inform you about construction projects. They say in Syracuse, we have two seasons, winter and construction. And this means that during the summer, many roads are closed to motorists and pedestrians for construction so that the streets and underlying infrastructure can be improved. Construction is unavoidable and ultimately benefits the city, but we don't want it to negatively impact you. So planned projects should not be a surprise to the public. We are launching a new online notification center where people can easily find out information about the upcoming roadway construction projects in Syracuse. Our new webpage, cityline.syrgov.net, contains a construction map which shows the locations and details for current and planned road projects in the city. You can go there now to see some of the upcoming construction season's projects. This map will be continuously updated as new information becomes available. We will be able to begin all of these exciting new initiatives during the upcoming construction season, thanks in part to Assemblyman Bill Magarelli. Last summer, he secured $10 million in funding from the state and municipal facilities program to help improve Syracuse's infrastructure. And we are excited to use these funds to kickstart our new infrastructure program. We are eager to move forward with this new paradigm in infrastructure management. And while all communities struggle with major infrastructure challenges, not every city has an IT and the kind of department heads that we have willing to work together. This is a rare opportunity, and the rollout of our new initiatives this year is a turning point for the city of Syracuse. We will once again tap the innovative spirit that has made Syracuse's history so rich. And we will be announcing more details about our new infrastructure programming soon. But I want to thank the I team for their creative expertise, as well as DPW Commissioner Pete O'Connor, Water Commissioner Debbie Summers, City Engineer Mary Robeson, and all the city staff who are dedicated to making our city stronger. Another technological aspect of city operations is the timing of our traffic signals. And believe me, I have heard plenty from constituents about the timing of our traffic signals, particularly heading into or out of downtown. And I live it myself every day. Since the mid-1990s, the city of Syracuse has conducted a series of projects to improve traffic safety, reduce drive times, and reduce vehicle emissions. Using closed-circuit television and computer-synchronized light timing, we collectively refer to these efforts as the Interconnect Project. The first phase of this program, completed in the early 2000s, involved 124 intersections in and around downtown and led to a reduction in vehicle delay between 14% and 18%, a reduction in fuel consumption between 7% and 14%, and a reduction in emissions between 9% and 13%. This year, we will complete the second phase of this project, and this project will enhance the CCTV and fiber optic communication network and add 44 new intersections into our city system. You've waited patiently in traffic lights, but you won't have to wait much longer for this project to improve your daily commutes in and around the city of Syracuse. In city government, we never forget that one of our primary responsibilities is public safety. The Syracuse Fire and Police Departments are challenged each day with responding to some of the most dangerous and tragic situations faced by people in our community. These men and women have stepped up and led their departments in new and creative ways. Using data, technology, and best practices, these departments have adapted to a new paradigm of service delivery. And while the efforts of Syracuse's bravest and finest have not waned, due to retirements, their ranks have thinned. And tonight, I am proud to announce that in April, our fire department will be welcoming a new class of 25 recruits. In our police department, we saw the retirement of 36 sworn officers in 2015 alone. And I have spoken to the former police chief and newly minted council majority leader and public safety chair, Steve Thompson. And he expressed to me on behalf of the council the need to add to our police force. And I agree. Accordingly, on March 7th, we will be swearing in a new class of 25 new police recruits. These recruits will begin the six-month academy, followed by 12 weeks of field training before they are assigned to duty. And I want to thank Fire Chief Paul Lenertz and Police Chief Frank Fowler for their ongoing and steadfast efforts to protect our entire community. Thank you. In closing, I want to tell you something that happened to me in December that has stayed with me. It is common for classes from our city schools to come and visit City Hall. And there is a standing rule that when students visit City Hall, they are welcome to visit the mayor's office and have their picture taken. In December, a class from Seymour School came to visit me, and each child got to sit at the mayor's desk for a picture. And as one young girl excitedly took her seat in my chair, I could see that she had duct tape wrapped around her old frame boots. Duct tape. Holding her boots together in a Syracuse winter. This is just one heart-wrenching example of the struggles we see every day that too many of our people are facing. And this story reminded me and should remind all of us of Dr. King's message. We are all part of an inescapable network of mutuality. The message itself is simple, but it is the action it inspires that is most important. Dr. King said in the same letter, human progress never rolls in on the wheels of inevitability. And we must actively, thoughtfully, and doggedly pursue the future we want for our city and the people who live here. We must continually commit ourselves to the work of lifting up our community. And we must create a concentration of opportunity to combat our concentration of poverty. And we must not stop until that opportunity is within reach for all. And to all of you in this room who have committed yourselves to this cause and are reaching each day to create this better future, I profoundly thank you for your efforts. And I thank you for being here tonight to listen to me. Have a good night. Thank you.
Almighty and eternal God, you have revealed your glory to all people. God of power and might, wisdom and justice, through your authority, this right is administered, laws are enacted, and judgment decreed. Assist with your spirit of wisdom and fortitude the mayor of our city, that her administration may be conducted in righteousness, and may she encourage due respect for virtue, and may she execute the laws with wisdom and mercy. And let the divine light of your wisdom direct to those of direct deliberations of our common council, and may they seek to preserve peace and promote happiness in our city, and continue to bring the blessings of liberty and equality to all. We likewise command to you your unbounded mercy to all the citizens of our city, that they may be blessed with knowledge made holy by the observance of your law, and may they preserve in union and in peace, which only you